Welcome, everyone. I'm Coach Neshi with Shootin' School Basketball, and you're watching Meet Your College Hoops Coach. We chat with college coaches to give you an inside view on their college and their basketball program. Today, we are really happy to have with us Coach John Peelan, who is the head coach at Hunter College. Coach has extensive experience as a Division III coach. He started his career coaching at Drew University, spent 2 years there, and then for 7 years was an assistant coach at New York University. And I had the pleasure of working with John for those 7 years. And now he's just completed his fifth season at Hunter. Coach, happy to have you with us today. Welcome.
Thanks for having me, Coach. Good to catch up.
Good. And prior to his coaching career on the Division III level, Coach played 4 seasons at Division III Gettysburg. So we have a wealth of experiences as a player and as a coach with Coach Peelan today. Coach, could you give us an overview of Hunter College?
Yeah, absolutely. So Hunter College is a school in the CUNY system. We're in the CUNY Athletic Conference, and you know, we're located right on the Upper East Side, 68th and Lexington. So it's a great location, easily accessible through the different subway lines, and great neighborhood, 2 blocks from Central Park. So it's a pretty exciting place to go to college.
Great. And Coach, what about the makeup of your roster as regards to the campus and dormitories or computers? What's kind of the makeup of your team, and what's kind of the makeup overall of the school?
Yep, so Hunter College is a good mix of commuters and students that stay in the dorms. We're pretty fortunate at Hunter. I think we have, you know, one of the best, if not the best, dorm situations in the CUNY. So we have 4 dorms. 3 of them are located right on the Upper East Side, and one of them is a little bit further downtown. So our team kind of mirrors that. We have a few guys that do commute that come from Queens and Brooklyn on a daily basis. Like I said, the subways are pretty accessible, so it's a good trip for them to where we're located. And then we do have a number of students that live in the dorms. We have a few guys on the team from California, 2 from Florida, 1 from Ohio. So, you know, the fact that we're right in the heart of Manhattan, right close to Central Park, allows us to recruit, you know, not just the 5 boroughs, but from all over the country. And we've been pretty lucky to get some guys that take advantage of the dorms that we have close to campus.
Great. And so, Coach, as a member of the CUNY Conference, the City University of New York, I know coaching, recruiting, various institutions, all institutions have their challenges. Mm-hmm. If you talk about Hunter and within your conference, what would you say might be unique about Hunter, Coach, as regards to, you know, what it has that maybe some of the other schools don't have?
Yeah, so one of the, you know, and it's both probably something that's very good that we like to talk about, and then other kids, you know, aren't quite as interested, but, you know, we are not a traditional campus. We are what Hunter calls a vertical campus. So we've got 3 buildings right on the Upper East Side. They go kind of down into the ground a few levels and then up as well. So, you know, if you're looking for a traditional campus, Hunter might not be, you know, what's right for you, which, mm-hmm. you know, for us in recruiting helps eliminate some kids right away and identify kids that really want to be in New York City and have the city as their campus. And, you know, where our dorms are located, you know, it's a 10-15 minute walk to our main campus. And the way we kind of equate it is if you're on a traditional campus, you might walk 15-20 minutes across, you know, green grass and lawn to get to your classes or your dorm, mm-hmm. or the gym.
Right.
And where we are, you're walking New York City blocks. So it's pretty exciting. And if you want the city life and you know, all that that has to offer, you know, people are pretty excited about Hunter right away.
Yes. Yes. And being coaching in New York City as long as I did, I certainly can appreciate where you're coming from with that. And certainly, as we know, Coach, as we work closely together for such a long time, we know that the city isn't for everyone.
Yep.
But it certainly is for a lot of students.
I would say one of the challenges, like you said, that we have is that, you know, some of the commuters, some of the local kids that, you know, we would like to recruit, you know, have aspirations of leaving New York City. So, you know, and that's a great opportunity for them to experience something different. But then on the flip side of it, we're lucky that we can attract some people that want to be in New York. So like I mentioned before, you know, we've got two kids from California, two from Florida, and another incoming guy coming from Ohio. So, you know, while there are some kids that New York City's not for them, there's plenty that that are excited to be there.
That's great. And Coach, what about the academic offerings? What are the most popular, you know, majors? What would you say might they be for the students that go to Hunter College?
Yeah, Hunter is a very, very high academic school. It's a challenging school. We have to recruit academically motivated kids that, you know, really place a priority on that. And, you know, we're strong in a lot of areas. I think that's one of our biggest strengths, is that Hunter does have a broad group of majors in our College of Arts and Science. But, you know, our strongest majors are in the sciences, psychology, sociology, you know, biology. If you want to be pre-med and follow some of those tracks, it's a very, very strong program. You know, we're pretty lucky with our location on the Upper East Side that we're close to, you know, Lenox Hill Hospital and Sloan Kettering. And a lot of our students are able to go, you know, shadow some doctors there and do some of their, you know, clinical hours at those places. But we also have a very good, you know, accounting and economics program for people that are more interested in some of the business side. We have a brand new business minor that is starting in the fall, which we're all very excited about, especially, you know, in the athletic department where, you know, business seems to be such a popular major. You know, and then another one that's really growing at Hunter is our media and communications major. We actually have a few guys on our team that have taken advantage of that and some of the digital media and online, you know, things that they can learn about is really taken off.
That's great, Coach. Sounds exciting. I know when there's a new program that comes in, certainly, you know, I know the school is anxious to bring in quality students. And I know that probably everyone is really getting the word out on the program. And wish you guys luck with that. Coach, let's talk a little bit about recruiting and kind of looking at it from the perspective as you're looking to bring in players into your program. From the basketball side of things, what would be considered quality players for your program? If you broke it down by like position, like what are you looking for in the players that you bring in?
Yeah, so we, you know, we're always just going to look for the best players that we can find, almost regardless of position, and we'll try to adapt, you know, our style of play or make some adjustments to fit those skill sets of the people that we bring in. But you know, the way things are, you know. For us, like we're always targeting guys that are skilled and that can shoot. You know, we've had some trouble, I would say, the last couple of years shooting threes and shooting a higher percentage. So it's been a high priority for us to bring in some guys that can knock down threes and help us out on the perimeter. You know, and then, you know, having been in the CUNYAC now for a few years, you know, we need guys that are tough and that have some size. It's a league that, you know, is probably a little bit older generally. So we, you know, we need guys that are tough and physical and can battle, you know, inside on a daily basis with some of the tougher teams in our league. So we've really placed an emphasis on size. And with that said, you know, and I'll go back to my time working for you, the three things that we look for in a big guy, right? And I'm sure you know this, but how are their hands, right? How do they run and how hard do they play? And, you know, beyond that, we'll work on any different skills and post moves and things like that. But we just want guys that, you know, play hard, can catch, and that can really run. So that's something that we really look for in the front court.
Great, great. So, and then if we talk a little bit about, like, the intangibles, Coach, what are there any, like, you know, give me one, if you can, like, one non-negotiable aspect of a player that, you know, you want in the kids you bring into your program?
Yeah, you know, I think this will probably be an answer that a lot of people give, but we always look for team first guys. And you can tell that when you watch somebody play, you know, the excitement that they might have for their teammate, you know, when their teammate does something well, because, you know, when they get to college, they might not be the star like they were in high school. So you've got to have some appreciation for, you know, what your teammates do and support them. And so being a team first guy is very important to us. We talk a lot about that in our program. We, you know, kind of have an acronym that we use with the word ACT. Like, we talk about, you have to act the right way. And, you know, on the court, off the court with your teammates, you've always got to act the right way. You know, we use the word ACT, appreciative, committed, and together. So that's something that we talk about a lot. So those are some of the things that, you know, it doesn't always stand out the first time you see somebody, but the more you watch somebody in recruiting, you can kind of tell what kind of person they are. And, you know, we've been pretty lucky to have pretty good people that we brought into our program and helped us really, you know, keep moving forward.
Yeah. And you know, that's certainly, you know, Coach, as you mentioned, all of us as coaches, we talk about that. And when we're smart, we follow that. You know, sometimes players and what they can do on the court, you know, could mesmerize us a bit and maybe even blind us to, you know, some of those intangibles that are so important to mm-hmm. make the success of the team and provide a quality experience for the entire team part of that equation. But it's as you know, it's not an easy thing as regards to, you know, getting that information. I mean, it involves, you know, either like obviously being able to get out to games yourself and watch the body language during the game and during timeouts. It's paying close attention in conversations that you have and certainly following up like with high school or AAU coaches to get more insight in who the young man is and more about what that young man is about. So there's a lot of legwork, and I know that you've worked certainly hard on that, John. It's something that we always talked about because we spend so much time with these young men that, you know, we want to be around quality people too. You know, it makes our job easier. It gives us more energy, and it makes us a better coach because if we're in a better frame of mind and we have team first guys, it's just much more of a pleasure to work under those circumstances, as you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, seasons are long and off seasons are long and 4-year college careers can be long and they're not always going to be, you know, easy and smooth. So, you know, you want to be around guys that are going to be, you know, that you want to be able to handle the ups and downs with, and you want to be excited to kind of take on a challenge with, and not somebody that's going to bring room down or be negative and complain and things like that. So, you know, that's something you can always tell. The other thing we look for a lot of times is somebody that is confident. Mm-hmm. You know, when things aren't going their way, they still exude confidence on the court, you know, off the court. They don't, you talked about body language, but, you know, how they handle themselves in conversations, because things aren't going to be easy, but you want somebody that can remain confident and keep things moving forward.
Yeah. So, and during the season, Coach, you've been at institutions, you know, good academic institutions mm-hmm. throughout your college experiences as a player and as a coach. And now as an experienced head coach, can you talk to us about the kind of the responsibility and how you navigate during the season, assisting your players with taking care of their classroom responsibilities mm-hmm. while they're juggling their basketball responsibilities?
Yeah, so we actually have a great program at Hunter. It's called our SOAR program, and it's an academic support program that we have in the athletic department with an academic advisor who supports all of our student athletes. And, you know, on top of, you know, the close interaction that myself and our assistant coaches will have with our players on a daily basis about their academics and just how they're doing in general, we actually have this other resource, the SOAR program, where they'll meet with an advisor on a weekly basis, just as a 5-minute check-in to, you know, to make sure that they're, you know, acclimating themselves to New York City, to their classes, that they're in the right classes, that they're moving towards graduation and, you know, things like that. So we've really done a great job at Hunter in kind of putting some resources in place that can help our student athletes be successful, you know, academically and outside of basketball as well. But really it's about developing the relationship, and you always have to kind of be available for your players as a coach. I think, you know, nowadays it's more text messaging, but even just a simple text checking in and following up to make sure, you know, how'd your test go? You're ready for your test. Things like that are just, you know, important ways to keep them on track and make sure that they know that you're, you know, committed to their academics as well. You know, even more than basketball.
Yeah. And, you know, as we know, Coach, the responsibilities as a head coach, extend beyond the court, you mm-hmm. know, and, you know, we ask so much of our student athletes, of our players, and building that bond that extends beyond the court and showing, you know, by how we interact with them and how we extend ourselves to our players regarding academics or personal situations that arise, strengthen those bonds. Mm-hmm. And certainly that's a big part of what this overall experience for these young men are. And I could go back to, you know, some of the challenges we faced, Coach, with some of our international players and the hand-holding that you had to do with, at different times. And, you know, I know how much that meant to our players, and certainly build strong bonds. And, you know, I was always impressed with that level of commitment. And some of those times were challenging. And certainly you showed a lot.
I think that's, you know, that's part of the fun, right? We want them to do well on the basketball court. We want to challenge them and make them better players. But, you know, we also have to kind of make sure we take care of them off the court and make sure they have everything they need. And, you know, I haven't quite gone any diners or anything like that lately, as you're referencing with some of our guys in the past. But, you know, it's certainly things that we'd be open to do to make sure that they're having a good experience.
Yeah. Coach, what about your kind of during the season as regards to like CUNY schedule, as regards to what mm-hmm. days of the week do you generally play? And yep. what is your practice schedule like? Not out of session, Coach, that, you know, when the guys aren't in class, that, mm-hmm. you know, that's kind of an easier one. But, you know, talk about like what your practice, you know, daily practice week to week is like when you guys are in session.
Sure. So we typically practice in the evenings, either 4 to 6 or 6 to 8, you know, sharing the gym a little bit with the women's basketball team and our volleyball team at times when they're in season, which is a good time to practice. It gives, you know, our student athletes the opportunity to focus on their academics throughout the day and take the classes that they need that don't really, you know, interfere with practice. And typically our kids will be done with class by 2 or 3 o'clock. It gives them some time. Okay. You know, to, you know, we have like a, we call it our classroom, but it's kind of an athlete hangout area. So they get in there, they get to kind of, you know, relax a little bit after class and hang out with each other and then get ready for practice at, like I said, either 4 or 6. You know, so it's a pretty good setup. It gives it gives them an opportunity to focus on their academics throughout the day, which is top priority, especially at a school like Hunter, which is, you know, can be challenging, and you really have to, you know, manage your time the right way and focus on the academics as much as possible. But then those practice times are good, because if we practice 4 to 6, I know our players a lot of times will go have dinner as a group and get to hang out with each other after practice as well. And so it seems to work out pretty well for us.
Yeah. And what about, Coach, I'm curious on this regarding like your practice structure mm-hmm. and how you utilize your assistant coaches. What would you say about how your practices are now, Coach, and how practices were, you know, how are they different or similar to when you and I worked together?
Yeah, I think they're probably pretty similar. We structure the first 20 to 30 minutes of skill work, and then, you know, kind of do either some offensive and defensive breakdown, and then we get to some scrimmage work. Mm-hmm. You know, we keep our practices to 2 hours. We don't go any more than that. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've been very lucky this year to have a new assistant coach, Connor Smith, who's done a great job with our program, especially with the individual work. He's done a really good job helping our guys get better and implementing some individual skill work drills that have really helped us.
That's great.
So, you know, our practices are, you know, pretty up-tempo, I would say. We do scrimmage a decent amount. I think it's important to let guys play 5-on-5 and kind of learn that way and learn through mistakes and learn in the full court and with, you know, having to react to different situations. And, you know, so it's worked out pretty well, I think, for us.
That's great. What about the CUNY schedule, Coach? Mm-hmm. Are there certain days that you guys are playing league games?
Yeah, so we usually play 1 or 2 league games in the first semester. We have typically we play on Tuesdays or Fridays. Okay. Some Saturday games in there, but for the most part, it's Tuesdays and Fridays, which is a pretty good schedule. You know, you have the Tuesday game, and then you have a day or two to kind of, you know, recover or assess how that went and get ready for the Friday game. And it's a competitive schedule. I mean, you know, we've had some teams the last couple of years that have had, you know, pretty good success. Baruch has been very good the last few years, along with, you know, John Jay had a very good year this year, and Brooklyn kind of came out of nowhere, but they made a run in the conference tournament to win the tournament. So there's some pretty good teams in our league, and it's a competitive schedule, and, you know, it's a fun league to be a part of.
Yeah. And, you know, I think you could speak to this certainly, Coach, and I know it like more secondhand, but I'm well aware of, you know, within the CUNY, the rivalries, the healthy rivalries, when you get into the conference tournament, it's a big deal. And the energy that is in those gymnasiums for those games, when it becomes do or die. And, you know, I know in most years, it's difficult for the CUNY to get more than one bid, like to the NCAA tournament. So, you know, it's all riding on that, you know, championship game. And you could have teams that may have had, you know, tremendous seasons. And if they get upset in the finals, like, they may not get in. And I know that's happened a number of times. And but the point of it is that you get into these really high-powered, high-energy, you know, great atmosphere tournament games. And I think that, you know, so many of the high school players, until they're able to watch some games up close and personal, can't really grasp, you know, the level of play, the competitive aspect, and the great atmosphere that goes into the CUNYAC games for in this example.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, obviously we always encourage, you know, as many kids that we recruit to come to our games and go see Division III games, because I do think they will be surprised at the level of talent and the level of play at the games, but also, like you said, the atmosphere. And when you talk about rivalries, you know, probably the biggest rival, no doubt about it, the biggest rival that we have in our conference is Peru. You know, we're right on the same street. So we have, they call it the Battle of Lexington. And you know, the first Friday in December is our homecoming event, and we always host Baruch. And then later in the second semester, they have their Battle of Lexington, and it's always against us. So we've had a pretty good rivalry. You know, we were fortunate this year to win at their place, win at Baruch, kind of almost at the buzzer. You know, it was one of the first wins that we've had over them in a while. So it was good to get that one. But like you said, the rivalries in the CUNY are great. And what makes it so great is that the schools are all so close, and a lot of the players know each other. They've grown up playing against each other, playing together. They play with each other in the summer. They work out together. So, you know, those rivalries become even more fun because of the relationships that the players have that they develop over the offseason. So it's a fun environment for sure.
Yeah. Coach, now as an offseason, this year is you're not your typical offseason. But what's a typical offseason for your players and for your coaches?
Yeah, so we like to, you know, we like to encourage our guys, you know, and recruit guys that are self-motivated and they really want to get better. So they do a really good job of kind of driving the off-season for themselves, whether that's organizing pickup or organizing times to, you know, get in the weight room and work out together. And I think one of the best parts, you know, obviously as Division III coaches, we wish we had more time with them in the off-season. But I think one of the good parts about not having that time is you can develop, see who develops and stands out as a leader in the offseason and who organizes that and who's kind of on top of the guys and encouraging guys, whether it's, you know, verbally or through text message to, you know, hey, we're gonna get in the weight room together today at 3 o'clock or let's meet at this time to play pickup. And, you know, that's not something we can do as coaches, but it's exciting to see, you know, kind of as the older guys graduate and move on and you move into another team and see how that team's gonna develop and who the leaders are gonna be. So, you know, our guys do a pretty good job of organizing themselves and playing pickup and, you know, finding leagues to play in and things like that. So, you know, that'll be their off season is really just trying to get better themselves and being in the weight room. You know, and then for coaches, like you said, it's different this year for sure. You know, one of the best parts about what we do is getting out in the summer and being in the gym recruiting and trying to find new players and new prospects for the program and, you know, getting to see other coaches and catch up with people that you haven't seen in a while. So, you know, we're obviously missing out on that this year, but it doesn't, you know, luckily technology, you know, is going to hopefully help us out in being able to identify and evaluate kids and, you know, highlight videos and game videos and emails and stuff like that. And then, you know, certainly Zoom situations like this able, you know, are going to let us kind of, you know, interact with coaches that we maybe haven't seen or haven't talked to. And I think, you know, coaches have done a great job for the past couple of weeks on Zoom doing coaching clinics, and there's been a ton of opportunities to learn and get better as a coach. So even though it's not ideal, it you know, it has we've found a way to make the best of it, I think.
Yeah, so great. And Coach, one last question for you. You know, with your many seasons now as an assistant and as a head coach, I know you've had, you know, certainly some memorable experiences and things that stay with you. Can you provide us with maybe, you know, one of the seasons that maybe stands out in your mind?
Sure.
That sure there have been a number, but if you can give us one maybe.
Yeah, only because I guess it's fresh in my mind still. Was this past season was kind of a unbelievable up and down season. We had pretty high expectations coming into the year. We had four seniors that had played a lot and were pretty good players. And for, you know, a variety of different reasons, everything that could go wrong went wrong for us. In the first semester, we started out 1-12 and we're really struggling. And, you know, luckily we had some pretty good leadership and guys, you know, stayed the course and stayed bought in. And we finally kind of started to play the way we thought we were capable. And we ended up winning 9 out of 12 down the stretch, including a 6-game winning streak, which, you know, included wins at Baruch, at Brooklyn, and at Staten Island, which were just all pretty exciting games. And, you know, we put ourselves in position to, you know, host a playoff game as the number 4 seed in the conference tournament, which was only, I think, we had done it 2 years ago, but only, I think, the third time that we finished in the top 4 in the last, like, 15 or 20 years. So, you know, it was memorable because it was a tale of two seasons, and it was, you know, as bad as it could get, and then it got to just about as good as it could get. And I think it just, you know, kind of speaks to the fact that seasons are long and you have to be committed and you have to be consistent on a daily basis, whether things are going your way or not. You know, you kind of just have to keep believing and keep grinding. And, you know, we caught a break. I think we won a game at Lehman, which was, you know, our second win of the season. And everybody was just kind of able to exhale, and we took off from there. Like I said, I think we won 9 out of 11 after that. You know, and we were in second place in the league for a while after, you know, not knowing what was going to happen there for a little bit. So it was memorable for both positive and, you know, negative reasons, I guess. But it was a fun season at the end.
Yeah, and, you know, it's easy to say as coaches, you know, we have to preach to our players never to give up. Mm-hmm. You know, stay the course, stay together. I mean, all things that we firmly believe in. But what adds the ammunition is that when you can recount, like, your past season to your players, and some of those players, like, could be returning players. I mean, we don't know when those obstacles are going to fall. Like, you could be in challenging situations in the next year or two, and, you know, you can recount this past season as to, you know, what you guys were able to pull out of. You know, it's not easy going 1-12 and turning it around, you know.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things that we talked about was just the resiliency that you have to not pack it in at 1-12. And, you know, whether we liked it or not, we had to play, you know, 12 more games, 13 more games, whatever the number was. Like, we had to play them whether we liked it or not. And, you know, people ask us, you know, well, what changed? Did somebody get hurt and come back? You know, nothing really changed. You know, there were some close games down the stretch in the 1-12 part where we could have or should have probably won the game, and we came up short or didn't make a play or whatever the case may be. And then all of a sudden we started making those plays, right? And, you know, it was something that, you know, I don't know that it happens too often that you go 1-12 and then, you know, 9-3 or whatever it was down the stretch. But we ended up finishing 8-6 in our league, which, you know, was pretty exciting from where we started. And we really kind of felt like the last couple weeks of the season that we really had a chance to win the whole conference tournament. Obviously we fell up short, but, you know, it was fun to put ourselves in position to play those meaningful games down the stretch.
Yeah, that's great, Coach. And this has been very informative, Coach. I certainly feel that, you know, the young men, the high school players and their families that go on to our casts and get a view of Hunter and yourself and your program certainly have something to look at. And I know from a personal standpoint, what you've done in your career and who you are as a person, certainly it has to be a consideration, I think, when young men are looking at possibly going to school in New York City if they want to continue basketball. Hunter College has to be a consideration, in my opinion. You know, I certainly will always remember fondly the time that we spent together, Coach. You know, over my tenure, you know, at 30 years, you know, which is amazing sometimes when I think about it, but I've had the great pleasure of having a lot of talented and good assistant coaches, and you're right at the top. And as far as tenure goes, John, you obviously should get a medal because you were the longest tenured assistant with me of 7 years.
I appreciate you letting me stick around that long.
That's a lifetime. But you know, as time flies, John, you've just completed 5 seasons. It's amazing.
It's pretty unbelievable to think it's been 5 years. And you know, I think I don't know that we've had that kind of signature season yet where we've really kind of accomplished everything we want to, but we've had, you know, some pretty small victories and we're moving in the right direction. And, you know, like I said, we've won, finished in the top four, two of the last 3 seasons, which hasn't really been done in a while at Hunter. And, so we like to keep moving forward and, you know, hopefully anybody on Staten Island that sees this or anybody anywhere else that sees this would take a long look at Hunter and, you know, certainly reach out to us if you have some interest in being right on the Upper East Side near Central Park. So
great. Great, Coach. Thanks again so much for your time.
Thanks,
Coach. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Yes, definitely. Thanks.
Take care now.